From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Hello, and welcome to this JAMA Clinical Review podcast. I am Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA, and I'm here today with Dr. Robert Kushner to discuss his obesity insight on the topic of managing adverse effects of incretin-based therapies for obesity. Dr. Kushner is Professor of Medicine and Medical Education at Northwestern University Feinberg School of Medicine. Welcome, Dr. Kushner, and thank you for joining us.
Oh, it's my pleasure, Mary. Thank you for having me.
I'd like to start with just an overview of the incretin-based therapies for weight loss that we'll be talking about today. So can you just give a brief overview of the medications and how effective they are for weight loss?
Well, the new highly effective medications, we call them incretin medications, and what they do is mimic two of the incretin hormones, that's GLP-1 and GIP, and by giving it back at very high pharmacologic doses, it emphasizes the appetite-suppressing effect of these medications. And weight loss with these medications have been, on the average, 15 to over 20%, which we've never seen before, Mary, with the older oral medications.
What are some of the common adverse effects of these medications, and also how common are they?
The adverse effects are primarily gastrointestinal, which is nausea, diarrhea, vomiting, and constipation. And they occur anywhere from about 30% up to 40% of individuals, at least in the phase 3 trials. And it's these GI adverse events that is the most important factor that may limit the adherence or the tolerability of these medications. So it's extremely important that clinicians do not prescribe the medications without counseling, because that is a setup for having patients discontinue medications primarily due to these GI adverse events.
Can you talk to us about what kind of counseling clinicians should do for GI adverse effects?
What we learned when we carried out the phase 3 trials is that we can successfully mitigate or lessen a great deal of these GI side effects by providing dietary counseling. Examples would be limiting the amount of food that one consumes, reducing fatty foods or greasy foods, planning your meals in advance so you don't go long periods of time without eating, avoiding or limiting alcohol as well as carbonated beverages. You can lessen a lot of these side effects by providing this counseling. And most of these side effects or adverse events occur usually within the first 1 or 2 days of the injection, because the injection is given once a week, and when the dose is escalated, which is often once a month.
And what are the most common GI adverse effects that you see?
The most common GI adverse effects are nausea, diarrhea, constipation, vomiting, as well as heartburn. And they occur anywhere from 25 to 35% of individuals, although they're typically reported as mild to moderate and short term.
And do we have a sense of how many people are not able to tolerate the medicines because of those side effects?
In the trials that we conducted, and of course, that's not real world experience, it's a controlled environment, only about 6 to 10% of participants actually drop out of the trials due to the GI adverse effects. But if we look at real world evidence, up to 50% of individuals are no longer taking the medications after 1 year. Now, we know from those types of trials, we don't know what the cause is. It could be lack of insurance, change of insurance, you know, if they're paying out of pocket and they can't afford it. But part of it is likely due to these GI adverse events that we're talking about.
And when you mentioned having people eat regular small meals and avoiding fatty foods, does that help with all of those GI side effects? What about, say, constipation? What do you recommend for that?
Right. Most of the recommendations I was making address the nausea, because these medications slow gastric emptying, and there's nausea that occurs also through the brainstem. Changing the dietary patterns, as I recommended, helps nausea. Constipation, we have to think about adding bulk or fiber in the diet, making sure the individual is well hydrated. You also may use some laxatives, such as Metamucil, or even a stimulant to help with bowel movements.
Your article talks about these medications reducing thirst, and I wondered if, do you talk to patients about that, and are they at risk for getting dehydrated?
We know for certain these medications reduce appetite and increase satiety and so forth, but there also may be a crossover to being thirsty, because they're all kind of in hypothalamus in the brain. And dehydration is something we have to be very careful about. When someone is not hungry, they may also interpret it as, I am not thirsty. So they may be going all day without drinking. That's particularly concerning with someone with underlying chronic kidney disease or an elderly individual.
And then also, what about the delayed gastric emptying in patients who have upcoming anesthesia for a procedure? What recommendation do you give on the medicines?
So we know that these medications reduce gastric emptying. We know that just from being incretin hormones. But most of the studies suggest that it is not permanent, that the gastric delay improves. It's somewhat controversial now whether individuals should be holding the medications for procedures like general anesthesia or, let's say, an upper endoscopy where we use a light sedation. A lot of the specialty groups are recommending that the medications be held for 1 to 2 weeks prior to a procedure, particularly one with general anesthesia. So we included that in our article.
And what about if someone has to miss a dose or two of medication? Talk about restarting them to avoid those adverse effects.
Yeah, that's a very important point. As we mentioned earlier, these gastrointestinal side effects are worse within the first 1 or 2 days of taking the medication, and then they lessen for the rest of the week. But there's something very interesting about these medications, that the longer you do not take them, another interval between dosing is lengthened, those side effects can reemerge at even a more severe level. So they are intended to be used once a week, and patients do fairly well. But if you're missing 1 to 2 doses for various reasons, a vacation, you didn't take it with you, you have some medical problems that reduces the frequency of dosing, it is very important that you may need to go to a lower dose in order to increase the tolerability of restarting it. I have many patients who will go away for a month or so on vacation, come back and go back to the higher dose they were on prior to the vacation, and they often have severe symptoms like nausea, some of them actually going to the emergency room because of vomiting and dehydration. So we have to be very careful when we restart a dose in which you've missed 1 or 2 doses.
So what is your rule of thumb? If they miss X amount of weeks, then you start how much lower dose?
Well, I start with a history. If someone has symptoms every time they use the medication or every time you dose escalate, I'm going to be very careful with them to bring the dose down. I'm also likely to be concerned about an older individual or someone with chronic medical problems because I would be concerned about prolonged vomiting or diarrhea or nausea.
Okay. What about monitoring patients for adequate nutrition? Since obviously these medicines reduce caloric consumption, what questions do you ask when you're seeing patients in follow-up?
Well, every time you see them, I take a good diet history, which may not be common for a lot of clinicians, but having someone do what we call 24-hour recall or a typical day to make sure they are eating adequately throughout the day and hydrating themselves is very, very important. And you're particularly paying attention to protein intake because with the excess loss of body weight, one can also lose muscle mass or lean body tissue. So you want to make sure there's an adequate amount of protein in the diet. We know the RDA is 0.8 grams per kilogram. In these individuals, we typically go higher, 1 milligram or more. If someone has excessive weight loss or an elderly individual, perhaps with sarcopenia and has loss of muscle mass, we may go as high as 1.3 grams per kilogram body weight.
Okay. And is exercise or resistance training, does that help protect against the sarcopenia?
Yeah, exercise is extremely important. There's two factors that we talk about in counseling that should be emphasized in individuals on these medications. That is a higher protein diet, which we just talked about. And the other is engagement in resistance exercise, that's weight training. So we counsel them on not only aerobic exercise, which improves fitness, but also resistance training, which holds on to muscle, as well as bone mineral density.
Are there any other adverse effects that you pay attention to that you'd like to discuss?
We're most concerned about an elderly individual or someone with chronic kidney disease, someone in their 50s or 60s, in which they are losing lean body mass and muscle mass just because of aging. And if that individual has a good response to these medications or a super response in which they're losing 20 or 25% of their body weight, we are concerned about them developing sarcopenia. So in those individuals, not only do we want to take a good history and counsel them, we also may want to do muscle fitness tests in the office that we typically can do as screening, such as sit to stand, hand grip, or knee extensor strength. These are examinations that we learn in neurology in medical school, such as extending our knee or a hand grip. And if you sense at all there is a weakness, that person needs further evaluation.
How about body composition? Is that something that can be done easily in the office?
You can do body composition, but I don't think it's quite ready for prime time among primary care. The most common techniques would be bioimpedance analysis, which is a machine that we could use in the office. Some have a bod pod, which is an air displacement. DEXA can be used, which we use for bone mineral density and osteoporosis. They're not commonly employed in the office setting. What we do need to do, however, is measure body weight. So you're looking for excessive weight loss, which would be more than 5% loss every month. Muscle testing, as we just said. And the other thing we want to measure long-term is waist circumference. Now, that is something we want to see because as someone loses weight, their waist circumference should diminish. And that's where the visceral fat or the abnormal dysfunctional fat is located.
Great. Thanks for joining today. This is Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.